Dr. Greene, thanks so much for joining me today. How are you doing?
Doing very well. Great to be here. I'm so excited that Stanford's looking at accelerating innovation in maternal and child health.
You can just feel the atmosphere here. It's a really exciting conference.
It is. I think this is one of the most exciting times in the history of medicine. Change is happening so fast. When you look outside of medicine, sometimes it's a little easier to see. You look at, for instance, Uber. Wasn't here a few years ago, and now it's the largest transportation company in history. We're at Stanford. It's bigger than the Transcontinental Railroad was that Leland Stanford founded this.
So why is medicine lagging behind?
I would say medicine is at the starting line now, that we're just about to begin to do the same kind of things that Uber and Airbnb have done. In the next few years, you'll see the government, major institutions, and companies we've never heard of before bringing together people to do health in a new way, a new era of citizen health.
Let's flash forward, let's say, 50 years.
Okay.
What are we going to have that's going to revolutionize medicine?
So I think there's a few different pieces of that. One is a revolution in our understanding of health. So much we don't know right now. For instance, the most commonly given medication to little kids 2 and under is acetaminophen.
Tylenol.
Exactly. And the FDA did a deep dive a couple years ago looking at all the existing research to see whether it prevents pain at that age, and we don't know. There's only been 10 studies at that age. And you think, well, if it works for older kids, it probably works for them. Often not the case.
Extrapolation.
Extrapolation is the way we've done it. It doesn't work. Mm-hmm. So what we can do, though, I heard from a nurse recently who she has a kid. She gives Tylenol all the time. She happens to have a pulse ox at home and a heart rate monitor at home. So she knows for that kid, when she gives Tylenol, oxygen's better, heart rate's down. It is solving pain. What we don't know is it the acetaminophen in the Tylenol or the sugar in the Tylenol?
Right. We
have one data point. But really quickly, really easily, we're going to have so many data points. We're going to solve problems. We're going to turn the lights on.
Dr. Greene, you are the chief medical officer of a company that's testing out a new device, and you brought it with you. Can you tell me a little bit about this little white orb?
This little white orb is called the Scanner Do Scout, and I'm holding up to my forehead, and you can see my heart rate tracing here on the phone. Yep. And it is gathering data on all my vital signs.
Oh, look, I can see it's loading.
You can see it loading.
So ultimately, what kinds of data can it show us?
So it will show my blood pressure and heart rate and temperature and oxygen levels. Here you can see right there. My heart rate's a little bit high, as is my blood pressure at the moment, but everything else looks pretty good.
And does it store this kind of data?
So it stores it, and you can track it over time really easily.
Really interesting.
Yep.
So there's a lot of talk in medicine about this idea of the quantified self. And some people are saying that we have too much data. People don't know what to do with it. What do you say to that?
So I think it's just the opposite. We have not enough data, but we also need ways to filter it, streamline it, to figure out the signal in the noise. And the exciting thing is computers are really good at that, at extracting from a lot of data what's the relevant information. So machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning is going to take all these different streams, your vital signs that you collect, as well as what your DNA is and what your microbiome is, and figure out what the patterns are. So you should be able to have just a dashboard or a single piece of paper that tells you what you need to know.
So does this turn each patient into their own physician?
In many ways, yeah. I think that in the Society for Participatory Medicine, we talk about moving patients from being mere passengers to responsible drivers of their own health and welcome as real colleagues into the system, as true partners. So in many ways, they're the primary care person in their life, and we're all there to support and provide context and as their consultants.
Really taking control of their own health.
Yes.
This sort of fancy technology is so exciting, and I think that everyone gets excited about this, the kind of Uber of medicine.
Yes.
But in some ways, we're lacking really basic types of healthcare. There's still huge holes in our safety nets in providing even basic food to people around the world. Do you think that eventually it will catch up, or do you think we're going to have a system that's fragmented?
I think eventually it'll catch up. And in many ways, if you look at the telephone system, they thought that it would never happen in the third world, because, or in the developing world, because laying all that cable is just not going to work. But it turns out, in many ways, they're ahead on the cellular level. You can find cell phones everywhere. And medicine is going to be like that. Devices that do so much that are not tethered to our big infrastructure here will spread, I think, very quickly. I mean, devices like this, one village could use one very easily today and replace a lot of more expensive equipment.
It's a really exciting time to be in medicine.
It is indeed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Greene.
Thank you. Great
really
being with you today.
Appreciate it.